saw an example of how we can mix HTML and PHP code. And one of the coolest things about PHP is also one of the worst things about PHP. All right. If you notice, we could stick, it was implied, anyhow, last time, I didn't actually say it, I don't think, but we can stick that PHP code anywhere we want to in our HTML code and add a little bit of programming logic. Or maybe another way to put it, add a little bit of dynamic behavior to the page. Now, we went through a fairly straightforward example where we had a chunk of PHP code that created a table. So we were creating some HTML with our PHP code. But it doesn't really end there, right? We could actually use PHP to write CSS, right? Why not? You know, we could have a block of PHP code, for example, that looked to see if you're on an Android device. And if you're on an Android device, give a link to some Android-related stuff. If you're on a iOS device, give a link to iOS stuff. If you're on a Windows machine, give a link to Windows stuff, and so on. For example, I'm thinking an organization that maybe had software that ran on a variety of different platforms. You could have links on that. And what you would do is you'd simply check out the request, look at the appropriate things in the request, and determine what platform you're on, and then display a block of HTML based on the platform that you're on. You could even, in some cases, I've seen this, use PHP to write some JavaScript. So you can do some wild stuff. The sky's the limit, as they say, because you have so much freedom in PHP to put your PHP declarations and your blocks of PHP code anywhere you want to within an HTML document. Now, what does Spider-Man always say? With power, with much power comes much responsibility, or something like that. It's the same thing with PHP, because you have to be careful with that, because you have so much freedom that if you're not careful, you can write some really, how can I say this? You can write some code that's really difficult to understand. All right? And what I'm going to do today, for the first part of today's class, is I'm going to rewrite the example that we went over last time using a slightly different technique for outputting HTML. All right? And I don't care which method you use, either like in the first example or like the second example. But you should understand them both. If for no other reason, you know, you might be working on a project where someone used one of the other, you know, a different sort of style of coding PHP, or you might see an example online or something like that. So therefore, you should understand how this works. All right. The way I think to still write good PHP code, even with all the freedom that you're given, is by following good programming practices, like indenting your code, creating functions for things, and so on. All right, those are the kinds of things that you want to do to make sure that your code is readable and understandable. And we'll be going over examples of that, functions and so on, as the course continues. But what I want to do first of all is go and rewrite this example that we had last time using a slightly different style of coding. Functionally, it will do the same thing, but stylistically, the PHP code will be different. So here is our example from last time. Let me download it. Copy copy it to my web server's location, which on this particular machine is c:inet/pub/www/root. This machine runs IIS, and that's the default web server root directory. It's going to complain about some things. Interesting thing is I can delete without any warning, but if I try to copy a new file in here, it gives me a security issue. I don't know. Write Bill Gates if you have questions about that. All right. So remember, I can't simply open this up in the browser. So I can't open the browser and simply open it up in it, because again, browsers don't understand PHP. So it gives me this. It doesn't give me an output. It doesn't understand the PHP code, so it thinks it's some kind of mutated HTML and just sort of outputs the code. I have to request that. The way I request it is by typing in the name of the web server. And again, if you're running a web server on your machine, the name is localhost by default. And then followed by the path to the file. Now, my file here is in the web server root, so I just need to put slash and then the name of the file, and that is first.php. So if I do that, then this is going to tell the server to execute that script, because web server software is installed on this machine and PHP is installed on this machine. So this machine understands PHP, and this machine understands getting requests for web pages and answering them. So if I do that, I get my nice chart of squares, 1 through 100 squared. All right. Now let's look at the code. As you can see, it contains HTML and PHP. What differentiates between the two, what tells the server what to do and what to execute as PHP code, is the PHP code is within this PHP block that looks like this. So anything within between those, that block, is interpreted by the web server as PHP. Wherever you see the word print, that is what's going to be sent to the browser. So this sends a start table tag to the browser. This sends a table row that contains two THs to the browser. This for loop by itself doesn't send anything to the browser. This doesn't send anything to the browser, but this does. Now, by virtue of the fact that this line of code is included within a loop, this is going to send not just one time to the browser, but every iteration through the loop, it's going to send to the browser this tag, which in this case consists of the value of n and the value of n squared. Notice that, again, the variable names start with a dollar sign in PHP. And notice that if it's within double quotes, PHP is smart enough to say, if it sees a variable name, to put the value in there. So it won't display dollar sign n, it will display the value of dollar sign n, which starts off at 1 and goes as long as I is less than, or rather n is less than or equal to 100, and increments n by 1 each time. Finally, we end the table with the end table tag, and then we end the page. Questions about this? Let's write version 2 of this. First two, that's a confusing name for something. Now, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm just going to rearrange some of the code. So some of the code's going to be, I'm going to put more of the code in HTML and less of the code in PHP. But effectively, it's going to do the same thing. Print table is the same thing as simply having a table tag. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm just going to make a table tag here. I'm going to make an end table tag here. get rid of those guys. This is simply creating these tags. So I can go and do this. Is something that has to be done in PHP, right? Because there's no such thing as a for loop in HTML. So, this part needs to be in PHP. But again, when I get to the print statement, well, that could just be plain HTML for the most part. And finally, the end loop has to be in PHP, because there's no such thing as an end loop. All right. So, what about these variables? That can't be in HTML. There's no such thing as variables in HTML. All right, that has to be, we're outputting a PHP variable there. So what I have to do is pop into PHP mode for just a second. Print the value of n, and then close PHP. And I can do the same thing here. All right, I think this will work. Let's give it a shot. So if I go here and type in first to PHP, this page is made via PHP, and we get the same thing. So, what's the difference between these two? Let's open these up side by side. In here, I went into PHP mode once, and any HTML I need to output, I simply outputted via print. Here, and then my HTML was partly static and partly dynamic. The static part was this. By static, I mean every single time it's going to output the exact same thing. By dynamic, I mean code like this, where it's going to, depending on circumstances, it's going to output something different. Now, in this case, all my static HTML, I just put in regular HTML. And literally the only thing that I code in PHP is the stuff that has to be coded in PHP, where I have this. Now, the loop has to be in PHP because there's no loops in HTML. And then the ending loop has to be in PHP. But within that, it's a plain block of HTML with the slight exception of this where I'm outputting PHP variables. Now, if you look at this, maybe both of these are equally understandable to you. Maybe like you see, yeah, okay, I can understand how that works. Maybe one of them is a little more clear than the other. I really don't care which method you use. I will use either of them depending on what seems right for the particular problem that I'm working on. All right? But you should sort of have an idea how both of these work. Now, here's what I think is the confusing part of PHP, and if you are going to use sort of a method like this, you need to be aware of, and you need to format your code to make it readable. This is actually not even an entire PHP instruction. It's the start of a PHP instruction, and down here is the bottom, is the end of it. So this bracket down here goes with this. Now, if you can imagine, it's easy to see that in this example where we have, you know, just a few lines of code, a few lines of HTML code in between. But if you can imagine in a larger page, all right, that could really get messy and really get confusing. So what is, you know, how do you make sure that it doesn't get confusing? By following the proper conventions for indenting and things like that. So you can look and say, oh, that belongs to that. The other thing we could do is we could use a function if there got to be too much code here. Here we're simply squaring a value. If you could imagine a more realistic example, maybe we're calculating shipping costs. You know, like if you want something shipped from here to there, you know, maybe we're preparing a shipping table where there's all sorts of complicated calculations and database lookups and all that. We could create a function to do the calculation. Whereas here our calculation is a one-liner, so there's really no need to create a function. Question on any of this? Now, here's an important thing to remember. Both of these, regardless of what method we use, if I look from the client's perspective, I'm only going to see HTML code. The HTML code might look a little bit different. It's formatted a little bit different in this case, but remember that regardless of what I do in terms of server-side scripting, the client still gets HTML code. And by HTML code, I mean HTML plus some JavaScript possibly and plus some CSS. Any questions about this? All right. I'm going to do a third example based on this now. Instead of always doing 1 to 100, it's going to do whatever the user keys in. So the user could do 10 through 50, or 1,000 through 2,000, or something like that. All right. So I'm going to change this. Instead of being hard-coded for 1 to 100, I'm going to get the value from a form, the starting and ending value. All right. And this is important because one of the ways, if you remember the diagram I had up there last time, one of the ways that one of the big things that server-side scripting does is allows the processing of user data from a form. All right, you go in to log into Canvas, you type in your username and password. Right, well, the server-side script in Canvas has to look at your user ID and password and decides if it's legit or not. Decides if it's a legal login. If it's legal, it lets you log in. If it's illegal, it displays an error message. When you do a Google search, you type in whatever your search term you are. The Google server-side script takes that and does a query and returns a search result based on what you typed in from the form. So processing data from a form is an important task that server-side scripting performs. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make a plain old HTML page that contains a form. And I'm going to start out simple, and I'm just going to make a simple form that says starting value, ending value. And I'm going to use that to call a script on the server side that is going to process and do the squared table for everything ranging from the starting value to the ending value. All right, so let's close all these. And I'm going to save this as first three. We'll come back to that one in a minute. And I'm going to make an HTML file. I'm going to cheat and copy the shell of my HTML file. And I'm going to create a form in here. Wrong. All covered in CISS 216, we covered basic forms. But we really didn't do anything with the forms, right? Because we said in that class that, well, you need to use server-side scripting to process it. So that's what we're going to do now. Type equals text, name equals start, ID equals start. This form is going to be just a plain old HTML page. Going to be a plain old HTML page. So I could save it as an HTML file. All right, this is the kind of thing that we've been doing. You know, we did stuff like this in CISS 216. Could I save it as a PHP file? There's nothing dynamic about this. So I don't have to save it as a PHP file. But could I save it as a PHP file? Sure, right? Because what's a PHP file? PHP file is simply a mix of HTML and PHP stuff. Well, this doesn't have any PHP stuff in it, but that's okay, all right? It still fits the definition. There's just no PHP stuff in this one. What might be the advantage of saving it as a PHP file instead of as an HTML file? If I wanted to add some PHP to it later, right? So, my sort of rule here, you know, they talk about the calves all in, right? It's the same way with PHP. If I'm writing a project in PHP, I'm going to make all my pages PHP, even if they don't need to be, because they might need to be at some point, all right? So, even though this form doesn't really require me to use PHP, I'm going to save it as a PHP file. Because later on, i.e. maybe next week, all right, I might go in and say, well, you know what, I might want to add some PHP code here. And if I did that, then I wouldn't have to go around in my navigation and all that kind of stuff and change the name from .html to .php. So I'm going to call this, I'm going to save it as a PHP file, even though I don't need to do that, all right, just because I might. So I'll go up here and say file, save, and I'll call it form.php. Now let's look at the code that I wrote. Let's look at the code that I wrote. All right. First thing you see on the form tag are two attributes, method and get, method and action. The method relates to how the data is going to be passed from the first page to the second page. I used a method of get, and that means that the data is going to be passed on the query string. You have two choices, get and post. In the case of get, the data is going to be passed via the query string. If I used a method of post, I would be sending the data with the request. Remember, the request contains all a bunch of other stuff, you know, like the location, not the location, but the IP address and all those things. I'd be sending the data that way. What's the difference? Well, there's a few differences, but the main difference that we're going to notice is that if I use GET, I'm actually going to be able to see the data as it's being passed. And that's very useful, at least as far as debugging goes. So if I was debugging, even if I wanted, if I knew eventually I would want to post the data to the second page, I'm going to use GET while I debug just to make sure the data goes the way that I would expect it to. All right. So GET is going to pass the data on the query string, and we'll see what that means in a minute here. Action simply means the name of the PHP script is going to be called, or the name of the server-side script is going to be called. And if you remember, I took and made a copy of the page that I've been working on and called it first three. All right? So that's what I put in there. That's the name of the script that's going to get called. All right? And it should do something with that form data and produce the output. Ideally, the output will be to show me a list of squares starting at the starting number and going until the ending number. All right. Here's something that's a little tricky, and we'll play with this a little bit. All right. Notice that on the inputs, I have both a name and an ID. All right. In this particular instance, I need both of them. All right. I need both of them. Why do I need both of them? I don't expect you to know this, but let's take a shot if you want to. Why do I need both a name and an ID? What's the ID going to be used for? The ID is used to attach this form element with the label. Label for equals start means that this label is for the thing that has an ID of start. So for people that are using screen readers and other assistive technology, the label ties text to a text box or to a drop-down or to whatever other form element. So I need the ID to do the label tag because the for points to an ID. I need the name because that's what is going to be sent to the server. The data is going to be sent to the server under this name. Now I cheated a little bit here. All right, I called both of them the same value, and that's what I typically do. The reason for that then is it's just less confusing for me. I call this form element start, and I know the name is start, and I know the ID is start. Then I just know the name is always going to be start, and I don't have to remember what I called it. But we'll play with this a little bit to show you what I mean. Same thing with the ending value. All right. Now, I'm going to save this. I'm going to copy these two files over. And I'm going to run this. My form, all right. I can put in a value, all right. So I'll put in from 4 to 44, and I click process. What is going to happen? Well, I haven't made any changes to this first three, right? It's going to go, still going to go from 1 to 100, all right. So, I will have connected those two pages, but I haven't really connected them because it doesn't do what I want it to do. So I'll go and click submit, and sure enough, it called first3.php, and notice what's on the query string. We'll look at that more closely. But again, because I haven't made the change yet to that, it still does 1 to 100. Because my second page doesn't take into account the form input. Let's go and let's look at this. This is the URL. All right. First3.php was what? It was the action of the form. So that's what got called on the server. The localhost part comes because if you simply specify the name, it assumes that it's on the same server in the same folder. So since my form was on localhost in the root, it assumes that first3 is going to be on localhost in the root. Now notice there's a question mark. And after the question mark, we should see something very, very, very familiar, right? We see start equals 4, end equals 4, submit equals process. What are those things? Well, those are query string elements, and notice they all look the same. They all have the name of something, an equal sign, and then a value. Well, if we look at our form, name of start, this had the value that I put in there, which was 4. Name of end has a value, which was 44. And this one had the name of submit. And the value was process. Now remember I said that it uses a name and not the ID, and I can sort of prove that to you if you were doubting me. I'll change the name briefly from start to start val and end to end val. If I do that, then I type in my 4 to 44 and process. Notice on the query string, it now says start val and end val. So it is the name that is used to pass it to the server. It's not the ID. I'm going to go back and change it back because I like to keep those things the same. Now, what I have to do now is I have to make that server-side script really work. All right? And how do I make it really work? Well, I have to pull those values off the query string. Or if I used a method of post, I'd have to pull them out of the form's request. Alright? Now, there's a couple of ways to do it. I'm going to talk about the most generic way, a way that will work whether it is post or get. And that is by using the request object. So, I can do this. I can create a variable in PHP that says start equals, and I can do it's been 6 months that I did PHP, so I'm going to double check my work before I run it. Yep. What do these two statements do? It grabs from the query string the value of the thing that has a name of start. And this one grabs a value of the thing that has a name end. So I'll simply use those in my loop. Instead of saying from 1 to 100, I'll say from start to and. And I should be in business. So let's look at this statement. $start is a PHP variable that I'm declaring. Remember, you don't really need to declare PHP variables, you just start using them. And PHP figures out what they are. That's good news and bad news. Alright, again. $_request is a built-in object in PHP. Alright, it's built-in. It has all the information that was sent as part of the request. And one of the things that was sent as part of the request is a query string. So I can pull out of the query string the thing that has the name start. Alright? So this means that it's part of the request. In our case, it's part of the query string. And the name on the query string is start. This does the exact same thing, except the name is and. And I can use that value in my loop, start and end. So I'm going to keep this open for a while. All right, let me go and copy these guys over. I can type in 5 to 55 process, and there we go. The page starts at 5 and goes until 55. Now, what if I were to change the value from get to post? That's my other alternative. Well, the good news is this request works both with get and post. So I should be able to do this without worrying about my code still working. So I can go back. Hit refresh, 4 to 44, and it did it. Notice the difference, though. I don't see those values on the query string. They're passed as part of the form collection that has all, or the request object that has all the other stuff in it. But the request still works. Now, alternatively, you can use, instead of $_request, you can use $_get. If you use get, or $_post, which will use post. The advantage of using $_request is that it works both for get and post. So it's one thing to remember instead of two. And if I change my mind about making it get or post, it continues to work. All right. The only time you'd possibly have a problem is if you're passing something on the query string and the form collection that had the same name, but that would be really, really rare, so don't worry about it. So my suggestion is, well, you could use get and post, and again, if you ever see an example that has get and post, just know that that's the same thing, is virtually the same thing to say $_request. All right, so where does that leave us? I'm going to change it back to get because I think, especially as we're first learning this, it's useful to see the values on the query string. All right. That way, if you're debugging, you can see what actually is getting passed. Because if I were to forget a name for something, let me change this back to. Let me get rid of the name start here. notice that if I forget a name, notice there is nothing up there for start. All right, so if you don't have a name in the form, it doesn't get sent on the query string. Let me make sure I get this correct. And copy it over again. And now we're going to be back in business. Oops. And it works. Now, here's a cliffhanger question. Well, yeah, if you'd, like, you were doing a password or something, you probably would use post. That way you wouldn't be able to, you know, someone looking over the shoulder, someone wouldn't be able to see it on the query string. You can use get, for example. You could actually, let's say you had a search by category or department, let's say, here at LC. You know, you could have a search where you pick the department from a drop-down, and it sent to the drop-down the value of the department. All right? So you did a search for CISS department. If you pass that on the query string, you could actually make a link that hard-coded the value on the query string. So you could have a hard-coded link to department equals CISS, or you could have a form that's submitted and submitted to the query string, submitted on the query string, department equals CISS, to the same page. And you could access the same page two different ways. So putting it on the query string gives more flexibility. Putting it, using it in the post is a little more secure. For what we're doing here, it really wouldn't matter one way, too much one way or another. Now, here's sort of the bad news, right? Because PHP is weakly typed, in other words, your variables are just variables. You can put anything into them, and PHP gives it the old college try, all right? If you were to type in some garbage in here and process it, boom, something bad happened, all right? What do you think really happened here? Because notice I didn't get an error message. I didn't even get that non-error message that I got last time that said, hey, something didn't work, but it didn't give me any details. It just gives me nothing. Probably treated them like they were zeros, I would guess. I don't know. Maybe, something like that. Because the loop was false right from the beginning, and it tells me that there's a problem. Likewise, what if I do this? 44 to 4. It does kind of the same thing, so it doesn't execute the loop at all. Neither of these things are particularly good, right? So how can we fix this? Well, we can fix this by doing validation, all right? Now, where are we going to put the validation? Well, we're going to put it in the client side. Why the client side? So that we can give an immediate response. We're also going to put it in the server side. Why are we going to put it in the server side?
Just in case.
Just in case. Just in case of what? Just in case someone disables their client-side scripting. You can disable in your browser client-side scripting, and anything that you write in JavaScript wouldn't run. I could also be calling this page from a couple different places, and whoever does the other code might not be as smart as me and might not do good client-side validation. So I might put server-side validation in for that reason. Now, not necessarily in this case, we're just taking squares of numbers. Obviously, this is a real simple example. But I might be doing more extensive validation on the server side, something that required like a database lookup. For examples, if these were like zip codes, right, I could allow, you know, I could allow the user to type in any five-digit number, all right, but I wouldn't have the resources to check that on the client side. when it got to the server, I might have a database of all the zip codes and be able to look up and say, hey, that value that you put in is not a valid zip code. So in addition to the redundancy, in case someone disables JavaScript or in case the page is used a couple different ways and someone slips up on the validation, I have the possibility of putting in more extensive validation on the server side. Now, how does a dropdown work? That's a good question. A dropdown works just like this. It takes the value of the dropdown and it puts it associated with the whatever name I've given to the dropdown. Alright? Likewise with checkboxes, likewise with other stuff. And we'll see examples of different form elements as we proceed. We'll also see examples of what? Of validation, both client and server-side validation. All right, questions? Okay, have a good weekend. We'll see those of you going to lab, we'll see you in lab.